Hi, Julia Usher, Recipes for a Sweet Life. As you all know, probably from watching my videos, after cookies, chocolate is my next favorite thing, and I've got an extra special chocolate treat for you this Easter. Rather than settling for just Mr. Bunny alone, you can have an all-chocolate Easter basket. We'll be making this beauty here today from head to toe, and it's nearly 100% chocolate, either modeling chocolate or solid chocolate, with a few other embellishments added in. So let's talk about what you'll need for this project. First of all, you'll need chocolate, of course. I have extensive notes in this video description and also in my melting chocolate video about different types of chocolate and how to handle them. Basically, today I'm working with a coating chocolate, and this particular chocolate does not require tempering. Tempering is a process of heating, cooling, and working the chocolate so that it sets with a nice, crisp, shiny finish and nice and hard, which is what you need for a freestanding project like this. Good news is coating chocolate, you just melt it and it sets up nice and shiny without any of that tempering process, so we're working with it today. The downside is it's not as flavorful as real chocolate. Real chocolate does, however, require tempering to stand upright like this, so it's a longer process, not as suited to beginners with chocolate. So today we're working with coating chocolate, but again, there is a trade-off, and I think flavor is the primary one. This is good, but not quite as delicious as real chocolate. So you'll need a dark version of that. We'll also need various molds for molding the basket. For the bottom piece, we're going to be using this plastic chocolate mold, which is about 5 inches in diameter on each side. The base of the basket will be made with the shallower dome, which is about 3 inches deep, and the handle will be formed through the deeper mold, with the deeper mold, which is about 4 inches deep. Additionally, if you want to make an all chocolate handle, you'll need some acetate strips. We're going to be making two versions of handles today. This one actually has fondant underneath it with modeling chocolate on top. You can replace the fondant with solid chocolate if you'd like. It's a little more tricky, but I'll be giving you those options if you don't want fondant in that basket at all. The other mold you'll need is something for the base. For this big basket, I'm using one of my empty cookie cutter containers. You could also use a deli lid, but I like the size of this one, so we'll probably be using the metal one today. So you don't need fancy molds necessarily that are store-bought. You can often find things around home that are suitable for the process, but I will have links, especially to this egg mold, in the video description. You'll also need various colors of modeling chocolate for this particular project. I've got 7. You could, of course, use fewer colors if you'd like. I've got a whole other video about how to make modeling chocolate, so I encourage you to step on over there. The modeling chocolate will be used for ribbons on the basket, also to make ribbon roses and leaves. And to work with it, you'll need a few extra little odds and ends, various cutters for cutting pieces that go on the base of the basket, and the little scallop trim around the top. You'll also need a sharp paring knife and a tracing wheel for creating textured marks on the ribbons that run up the side of the basket. This is a sewing tool, often handy with decorating as well. Of course, you'll need those ribbon roses and leaves, which I've talked about how to make in another video, so I refer you over there, and other small embellishments. Dragees, sugar beads, royal icing transfers, which I made, that are slightly larger, and of course, to make the leaves that go on the sides of the basket, you'll need various cutters and embossing tools, plunger cutters or embossing plates, either or. So let's get started. So first step is molding the chocolate pieces, and the key thing is to make sure your molds are completely clean before you put any chocolate in them, because if they're not, any grease or spotting on here will also appear on the chocolate. I'm going to start by molding the basket base. And for that, I'm just taking my melted coating chocolate again. I didn't have to temper it because it's coating chocolate and not real chocolate. And I've got a whole other video on how to melt in a double boiler. You can also use a microwave. I just happen to not have one. So I've put a few tablespoons in and want to quickly rotate it around before it has the opportunity to set up. This particular chocolate sets very quickly. And I want to get it all the way to the top edge. I might need just a little bit more. And then I'm going to stick it in the freezer to accelerate the setting process, but pull it out before it's completely set and rotate the chocolate around one more time. I like to set it with it sitting like this as opposed to upside down because I get a cleaner edge up here if I do that. But then some of the chocolate settles down to the bottom like so, and I want to make sure we get enough up on the sides that it's amply thick. So I'm going to rotate it around. It doesn't matter if you overflow. You really want to get up over the edges at this point. And I'll dump the excess out over the bowl now. And then take a clean bladed knife, spatula rather, and just really clean up that upper edge. You want that as clean as possible so that it disengages from the mold once it's chilled and falls out without breaking that edge. Now you notice already some chocolate's draining down, and I'm just going to give it another rotation of it to make sure that I get a relatively thick edge. I'm going to set that in. I don't want it super thick, but it's not going to be more than an eighth of an inch at the most. I just don't want it all settling into the bottom and having a really thick bottom. So I'm going to set it in the freezer now to partially set. We'll come back, clean up the edge once more, and rotate it one more time before it's fully set. Okay, so it's been partially setting, and you can see I've got some chocolate still in there that's freely moving. So I'm just going to rotate it around, and it's going to hit some cold chocolate there and hopefully set up and reinforce that side wall a little bit. And I may do this once or twice, depending on how long it takes to set. And my last step is now I've got a heated blade. I just ran it under the flame on my stove, and I'm just going to really clean that edge one more time. I think that's pretty good. I'm going to set it back in the freezer to set partially, but I don't want to leave it in there too long, because if I leave it in there too long, this collects moisture, and then when I disengage it and unmold it, the chocolate isn't as shiny as it potentially could be. So just to maybe a few minutes, and then I'll let it set the remainder at room temperature upside down, and eventually it'll just drop out of the mold. So the second piece we need is for the base, the actual foot of the basket, and I am going to, I think, pipe this in just so I get it in more even. We'll see how that works, because I want this to be nice and level. Kind of working it around, and I don't need this too thick, maybe about an eighth of an inch thick. You just want to make sure you shake it out so it's nice and level. And that'll go in the freezer or fridge to partially set, but again, not too long or it'll attract moisture from the fridge and not set as shiny. Okay, the last and optional step is making a chocolate strip, the under arch, if you will, of the handle. And to do that, you want to cut an acetate strip. This is going to actually be your mold. We're going to spread chocolate on it, lift it up, and then place it in the longer side of the mold to actually set into shape. This is a little more fragile than using a fondant underpiece, so I am going to show you both ways. This would be something for more of an advanced chocolate person. So because it is very, very thin, you'll see it's the chocolate layer is really not much thicker than the thickness of the acetate. So you're going to make a mess here. Be prepared. You get your counter dirty, but you can scrape up the extra and just remelt it for another project. So I want to get it somewhat smooth. And then I'm going to find an edge, the edge with my paring knife. I'm going to tack a little bit of chocolate there and there just to keep it from flopping down inside the egg. And this strip is about a half an inch wide. It could be any thickness you want, but obviously the wider it is, the more delicate. And it's a little bit longer than the mold. And we would just leave it like that. It will set up at room temperature eventually, and I can peel it off the sheet. And I may actually, before it's fully set, just lie it on the back side of the mold, because sometimes it has a tendency to curl in as it sets. I'm hoping the chocolate here will prevent it from curling in as it sets, but we'll watch that and see what happens. So as I said, I only partially set this in the fridge or freezer until the chocolate's no longer drippy. You can see it's not going anywhere. And then I let it fully set. I don't think it's quite set enough in the center, by inverting it onto cardboard and just letting it gravity kind of weigh it down. And eventually it'll begin to separate from the mold on its own if you're using coating chocolate or you've properly tempered real chocolate. And you can see some separation beginning to occur here. Here's the handle. Here's what I mentioned about it. If it separates from the sides, it'll curl up on itself as it sets. And we don't want it to get too narrow. So what you can do, while it's still flexible, if it's fully set, it'll break, is just let it fully set like so on the back side once the chocolate's no longer drippy. And then it might need a little bit more time before I can peel it off the acetate. Now, it is in kind of a precarious position here, so if you want to, you can also leave it to set on its side. What we're trying to do is just keep the ends from closing in on themselves so that they fit to the edge of the basket when it's time for assembly. So, having done that, I think the acetate's ready to remove. And you'll know if it peels away nicely on its own that it is. And I'm peeling away the acetate, I'm not tugging on the chocolate because this is very, very fragile, as you can see. So this is a base I had previously unmolded, and I want to show you how super shiny it is, except for the spot in the center, which is the result of using coating chocolate or nicely tempered chocolate. If you haven't tempered the chocolate, it's gonna set dull. Now, this is the one that I had in the freezer, and I had it in there kind of long. So it popped right out immediately. I just inverted it onto cardboard, and you can see it's looking pretty good. So now this piece has been sitting for a while, and as you can see, it's pretty disengaged from the mold. I think it's just going to slip right out. It's on its own, which it is, which is lovely. And don't worry if you see any cracks. This is really, really clean. But if you see any cracks or chips at the bottom, don't worry about that. I'm going to be putting a band of dark modeling chocolate around the bottom to kind of reinforce that edge. The modeling chocolate will make it easier to handle as well as we continue to decorate it. Okay, so now we're gonna decorate our beautiful chocolate dome. It's gorgeous as it is, isn't it? But I wanna liven it up with some spring stripes and scallops, as much like the one up there, but I'm gonna do a slightly different color scheme. So I've got my modeling chocolate out now, and I've pre-cut a chocolate band that's going to go around the bottom to kind of reinforce that edge, as I discussed. I've also pre-cut a few other pieces. I have a whole other video about how to roll and create ribbons. I'll show you one in this video, but if you need more details, I do refer you over to that. So I am going to stick this band down first to reinforce the edge before we get too far along. And to do that, I'm going to work with corn syrup. But whenever I glue down thin pieces like modeling chocolate or fondant, I prefer to use corn syrup as opposed to royal icing. And then I'm just sticking it up, applying the corn syrup gradually. And so I'll take this as far as I can go. It's starting to misshape the band at the end, so I want to cut it where it's a little more misshapen with my small scissors. And this will become the back. There's always a seam with this ribbon work. That'll become the back. It could get covered with a flower if you'd like. Now my next step is I like to put a disc here of color because I'm going to be laying stripes, and if I were to lay stripes all the way across, they'd crisscross and then be kind of lumpy in the center, and I want it to be nice and smooth on the bottom so when I mount it, it doesn't fall to either side. So I'm going to start by putting a round little disc in the center, and I think I'm going to use my light green to cut it, and I'll just show you how I roll this out on my pasta machine since this piece isn't already pre-cut. So I'd like to get the modeling chocolate. It will firm up. So you'll notice I'm working the modeling chocolate before I put it through the pasta machine, and that's because if it sits for any period of time, it does get pretty solid. But the warmth of your hands will quickly get it back to a working consistency. In fact, it's pretty warm in here, so this is almost too sticky. I'm going to roll it to the number 3 setting on my pasta machine. Every pasta machine is a little bit different. Mine ranges from 1 to 9 with the larger numbers being the closer distance between the roller blades and thus the thinner piece that will come out. And it is a little tacky, so I'm just going to dust it with a little powdered sugar. And now I'm going to take it down to 3. That'll leave it about 1/16 of an inch thick, thereabouts. And that looks nice and smooth. And I'm just going to cut this piece. And we'll eventually lay it dead center, and then I don't have to have my stripes going all the way over the top. But before I stick that down, let me just show you how I do a typical blue stripe, because we'll be laying those next. They have a little texturing on them, so they're a little novel. And I just want to make sure my surface is dusted enough that I can lift that up once I'm done cutting. These stripes are about 5/8 of an inch wide, I believe. So I start by cutting one straight edge, And I try to leave everything on the counter without moving it. If it shifts, then it won't, the next few lines won't look as straight. And I'm just advancing my ruler a little bit so I can create that stitching mark with my tracing wheel that I introduced earlier on one side of the ribbon. Lift it up. Then I'll measure in 5/8 of an inch. Just do a little tick mark there on either end. That's about right. Line it up. Then I'm going to move the ruler up and over a little bit so I can get the other edge of stitching on there. And I did a pretty good job on that. So that's a nicely stitched piece. I don't think I'll need them quite so long. No more than half of that, so I'll cut that in half. And those pieces will go up once we get the green one stuck down. Now to stick this piece down, again, corn syrup, just a little bit. I'm going to start it on the chocolate, just in the center, and then make sure I've got it nicely centered from this direction before I press it down. And also nicely centered from this direction. And then when I've got it situated, I'll come in with my tacky brush and just put a little corn syrup on the edges before I put it into place. Okay, so now I'm ready to put the ribbons down again. A little bit of corn syrup. And I mark off quadrants and then bisect quadrants. So this one I'm trying to lay dead center. And I didn't put corn syrup all the way to the bottom until I'm sure where it's going to land. So I'll tack a little bit more down here. And then make sure it's coming down straight. And then cut the extra. And then make sure it's sitting nice and flush against all the contours just by gently pressing it in. And now I'm going to do the opposing one directly across and just bisect these areas until I get 8 stripes down in the blue color, and then we're going to lay thinner white ones in between. So I've got one quadrant of the blue done. I just proceed the same way all the way around to get the other blue stripes down. And once that's all done, I'd come in with white stripes. It's easier once everything's laid, but just to show you what I mean, I'm going to go ahead and just work this one quadrant since it is done. And I'm laying thinner white stripes. These might be a little shy of 1/4 inch wide. And they're just going to go down the exact same way in between the blue stripes. Here I'm anchoring in the opposite direction, just not for any real reason. So I'm going to cut at the top. The danger of doing that is it flops onto the rest of it. I cut a little bit onto that blue ribbon, but again, I think that's going to be covered by a piece I'm putting over it later. I just want to straighten that up. If it goes down a little crooked, you can kind of cheat it with your side of your knife. And then I'd repeat that all the way around. So I've advanced a little bit further forward to adding some scallop details and adding that purple piece that hides the seams between the stripes and the green area. And that, again, was just simply cut by rolling out my purple modeling chocolate and cutting it both with the fluted cutter and then a straight plain round cutter to create a ring. Now, as for these scallops, I've got some down already. They're, again, purposely there to hide the connection point between the seams. I also added a little blue band down at the bottom on top of the chocolate band to tie into these blue stripes. But I do want to kind of conceal that seam, and that's why they're strategically placed there. Plus, they look pretty darn cute. And to make those, I just rolled out light green modeling chocolate and the purple again. Cut the purple with this, I think it's about a 1 1/4 inch scallop cutter. I'll have all the dimensions in the video description. And then a 7/8 inch round for the center. And my next step is to stick those together. Back to the handy corn syrup, not very much of it. And it's nice to give them a little drying time together before you cut them in half. We're going to be cutting each in half to create two scallops. And by a little drying time, I mean a few minutes. If you cut them right away, sometimes the green piece will slide on top of the purple piece. So let me put those up that have been drying for a period of time, and then I'll come back and cut those in half. Same process. Just a little bit of corn syrup. That's probably too much. Okay, so I'm just tucking it in so it sits all the way down, flush against the blue band. And it's sitting nicely contoured to the dome itself. No edges sticking out. Okay, so this is just lovely as it is, if you ask me, and quite striking. However, I'm a more is more person, as I always say, so there's a whole range of additional embellishment you could put on it. I'm going to keep it relatively simple and just put little white royal icing transfers. And again, I have a whole other video about how to make these royal icing pieces. You pipe them on a piece of acetate, let them dry, and then they pop off. I'm just going to put one at each of these seams. Now, to put these transfers down, I just need a little thick royal icing glue, and I like to do this, as I said, when the modeling chocolate's still somewhat pliable, so I can kind of nestle it in there and tuck it in. So something like that. And I'm going to continue that way all the way around. So I've got all my white royal icing transfers on. I think it looks beautiful as is. Of course, the amount of detail you want to use is completely up to you. You could add the additional dots around here and here, as I did on those baskets. But it's just a matter of how much time you want to invest in the project. So it's time to decorate the base, really using the exact same techniques we used on the side. I'm going to start by trimming out the side of it with a little blue band that I cut out of the blue modeling chocolate, and I put just a single tracing wheel mark down the center. Hopefully that's, yeah, it's just about high enough. It doesn't cover the entire side, but it covers most of it. Just want to give a little color down there, but I do want some chocolate peeking out. And down goes the corn syrup. Now I've cut a disc, again roll to the number 3 setting on my pasta machine with the purple pasta using a fluted round cutter, and I'll have the dimensions in the video description, and I'm just going to anchor that in the middle. That looks pretty good. Now I'll just press it into place. I'm going to do a second disc cut in green, same way, and then we'll do a third disc with white that I don't want to apply until we're ready to mount the pieces together, because I'd like that to be a little bit soft. And that looks good. And now I am going to detail this a little bit since I have the white beads on the body. I do want some little white accent pieces on this purple part. So I'm going to pipe those with royal icing because they are rather small. The reason I use the transfers on the body is because they're rather large. If I were to pipe them directly on the body with my loose icing, they'd probably drain off. But for small ones on a flat surface, I can get away with royal icing. So I just got my white beadwork icing and I'm going to go all the way around. So my beads have dried. I've also since mounted, again with corn syrup, a little bit of white modeling chocolate, a smaller disc. And I just done this right before I intend to mount it because I want it to have a little bit of give so that this will kind of settle into it. It just gives a little more stability to the construction if it can kind of nest in soft modeling chocolate a little bit. Nonetheless, I am going to use a little bit of white glue here in the center. And this will probably need propping until it's completely dry. So let me scooch this off. I like to slide this forward. And I've got my seam towards the back, and I want to make sure the basket seam also gets placed towards the back. And before I really press it into place, I want to make sure it's centered nice side to side and also front to back. And I just press it in ever so gently because this is fragile chocolate. Look how thin the rim is. And if you see any glue peeking out, now's the time to get it. I am going to prop it against the dragees because they're the least the element that's least likely to smush because my modeling chocolate's still soft on the sides. So we're ready for the final assembly process. Let me talk first about the handles. As you know, we had the chocolate one we did earlier, and all I did to it was I lined it with a little bit of blue modeling chocolate and a little bit of purple modeling chocolate to match the basket. And then I let it set again. Typically I let it set overnight because the addition of the modeling chocolate can soften the chocolate underneath. And then it's firm enough that I can place into the basket. Now, in addition to that piece, this is a little fragile because you can see how thin that chocolate is. There is the possibility of the underlying chocolate snapping under the weight of the modeling chocolate if this hasn't set enough. So if you're at all concerned about that, you can resort to fondant as the underlying piece. I just shaped this fondant piece the way I shaped the chocolate piece, cut a strip and laid it over the egg mold or in the egg mold and let it dry overnight. And then I lined it with a dark modeling chocolate followed by the purple modeling chocolate and again let it dry overnight because the addition of these modeling chocolates against fondant also causes the fondant to go a little soft. I'm working with a relatively fast setting fondant as well, satin ice. So overnight it'll dry very, very rigid and it's sized just perfectly to fit into our basket. I may have to push it in a little bit at the bottom to clear the edges. Hopefully that won't snap it. There's a little bit of give to it, as you can see. I like to have the handle pretty close to the top so it's tall. If we're just to glue it like so, chances are it'd slide down as it was drying. So what I'm going to do is put these little modeling chocolate supports. It's actually a big chunk of my dark modeling chocolate. I'm going to lay one right up under the band where the handle's going to come out of on one side and lay the other one on the other side. And they're long, so they're going to hang down into the basket a little bit, but provide a support that I can rest the handle on. So to get this chocolate piece in, just coating it with a little corn syrup as always, and I'm going to put it maybe an eighth to a quarter of an inch below the surface of the basket. Once I get them roughly in position, I'll put the handle resting on them and see how it looks. And I want it pretty much underneath this blue ribbon, which is where the handle's gonna pop up out of. Now, I'm not worried about how it really looks from the inside because we're gonna fill it with grass and goodies. So this big chunk, I'd rather have it there for safety purposes than not to have it there at all. Same thing on the other side. So now I've got those supports in, let's see if they're enough to catch the handle and to have the handle sit level. And I think that looks pretty good. I think the right side may need to come up a little bit. So I'm pushing it up a little bit. And now I'm ready to glue it in place. Now you could use chocolate, melted chocolate to glue it in place and just hold it there till the chocolate sets. That'll set really, really fast though, especially if you're working with coating chocolate. So I prefer actually to glue with royal icing. You'll notice I did that at the base as well. And that's because if I don't place it exactly where I want it, I have the ability to take it apart and move it around and clean it up and move it around and reposition it. It's harder to do that in working with chocolate as the glue, but you could conceivably. So I've got brown thick icing glue that I'm going to use at the bottom here to secure the handle, and we're going to use it pretty liberally. And we're going to cover that seam in a later step. So I'm just plunging it in there. And this may or may not need propping to stay upright. So I am going to add another piece that's going to give it more stability and cover that ugly seam with all that icing. So I've cut these modeling chocolate discs just with a round cutter, rolled it to number 3 setting on my pasta machine. And I'm just going to trim it flat on the top. And we're going to stick that up against the edge of the handle to cover that seam and to wrap around the handle. It'll neaten up the inside of the basket and also give me greater assurance that handle's not going to go anywhere. And if I need to add a little corn syrup to it to stick it down, That's fine too, but I'm sticking it into that wet brown icing and that seems to be working just fine. So same thing on the other side. And just get it high enough to overlap with the handle and cover that seam. So my last step is adorning this with a few little flowers. These are ribbon roses made out of modeling chocolate as well. I cut a ribbon, a strip, and then wind it up, and I have a whole nother video that shows how to do that. Likewise, a very recent video showed how to make these textured leaves using embosser plunger cutters that I showed early on, or embossing plates between cut modeling chocolate. And I'm going to put one up at the corner here and possibly one down on the opposing side on the base. I'm just going to glue them in place with a little bit of brown glue just so it is less likely to show up as opposed to white glue. And if you'd like, if you're fussy, you can also cover these little tails that I've left on with another swatch of the brown modeling chocolate to cover the ends. But I'm not going to worry about that today. I'm just going to glue that up. I want it kind of facing forward in the final construction. So I think that looks good. I'm pressing very gingerly because my basket's still a little wobbly, not completely dry. And then we'll tuck in a few leaves as well here and there. Maybe just two at the top. I'm going to switch to a little bit of white glue for this leaf coming in the front because it's very close to colored ribbons and I don't want to get brown on those ribbons. So that looks really nice, I think, with the way it is, just like so. And again, you can see some of those little pieces stuck there if you wanted to cover that with more brown dough like we did there. You could. I'd wait for it to dry a little bit before I did that. I'm just going to put a tiny little flower, I think, down at the bottom, kind of hanging off the edge, much as I did on the one up there. So I'm just going to put a little rose, I think, down yonder, poking forward. And here I am going to use white icing glue, just because it's a little less likely to get on those colored pieces and mess them up. Kind of facing everything forward if I can, and then tucking some leaves in around it. Same process. Maybe I'll put the leaves down first. So I think she looks absolutely beautiful with those two roses just as the final touches. But I give her now at least a couple of hours of drying time, if not overnight, just so she's completely secure before you fill her with Easter basket goodies. And then of course, the sky's the limit. I like to keep my Easter basket goodies to strictly edibles, so I filled mine in the foreground with edible wafer paper grass, you can actually eat that, as well as chocolate eggs. So I hope you enjoyed this all chocolate project. Have a great Easter and live sweetly.